cost of capital. The main objective of a business firm is to maximize wealth of its shareholders in the long run. Now, in order to achieve that, the management should invest only in those projects which gives a return in excess of the cost of funds invested in that project. That means the returns generated from any project should be greater than the cost of capital invested in the project. Okay. So for taking any financial decision, the concept of cost of capital becomes at most important. Now, what is cost of capital then? The cost of capital is the rate of return the company has to pay to the various suppliers of funds. Now, who are the suppliers of fund? The suppliers of funds are shareholders and lenders. So any return that is to be paid to the shareholders and lenders for raising finance from them is called as the cost of capital. Now, let us see sources of funds, how the sources of funds are classified. The sources of funds, as we have seen, is classified as debt and equity. Debt matlab we have taken it from lenders, and equity means it is from shareholders. The funds raised from shareholders are called as equity, and the funds raised from lenders are called as debt. Okay. Debt is further classified as bonds or debentures or bonds or term loans. When it comes to equity, equity finance can be raised through equity shares, preference shares, or retained earnings. Now, retained earnings are also called as internal source of finance. Now, what is the cost involved in this different type of instruments? Let's understand. First, when it comes to debt fund, that is when it comes to debentures or bonds or term loan, the company has to pay a fixed rate of return to the debt holders. That means here there is a fixed commitment on the part of the company to pay a rate of return that we called it as interest. So here we have a fixed interest involved, which becomes the cost of that fund. Similarly, when it comes to preference share, there is a fixed dividend involved. So that becomes the cost of taking this fund. So cost of raising this fund is the fixed dividend involved. That is preference shares in case of preference shares. But when it comes of equity shares, there is no such fixed dividend involved. That does not mean ki equity share comes free of cost. Even though there is no fixed dividend involved, but the shareholders expect some dividend from the company. So this is calculated, the cost is calculated on the basis of expected dividend. Again, the shareholders want an increase in the dividend. So growth rate in dividend is expected by the equity shareholders. So this too becomes the base for calculating the cost of equity shares. So equity shares ka cost is calculated on the basis of expected dividend and the growth rate expectations of dividend by the equity shareholders. Now then, how to calculate this cost of retained earnings? Now retained earnings has got an implicit cost. Now, the cost of retained earnings, first understand what does retained earnings means. Retained earning is that part of your earnings which is not distributed as dividend to the equity shareholders. So they are the equity shareholders earnings which the company is holding, and hence the cost of retained earnings is dependent on cost of equity shares. So cost of retained earnings is calculated on the basis of cost of equity shares. Now let us understand how to calculate the cost of each of this fund in details. So first, to begin with, we will be calculating cost of debt, and in cost of debt we will be starting with cost of term loans. Before starting with cost of debt, let us understand the concept of tax shield which is involved in debt capital. So tax shield. Now what is this phenomena of tax shield means? Let us understand this with the help of an example before arriving at the cost of debt. For example, net profit before interest and tax that a company is earning, let us assume it is as 1 lakh. Less, if the company raises funds through debt, then the company have to pay a fixed rate of return in the form of interest. So interest on debt इफ सपोज द कंपनी पेज इंटरेस्ट ऑन डेट टू बी रुपीज 20,000, देन आफ्टर डिडक्टिंग दैट इंटरेस्ट वॉट एवर लेफ्ट इज 80,000 विद द कंपनी. वी विल बी कॉलिंग दिस एज नेट प्रॉफिट बिफोर टैक्स. नाउ दिस नेट प्रॉफिट बिफोर टैक्स इज डिडक्टेड फ्रॉम द टैक्स रेट एप्लीकेबल टू द कंपनी. लेट इज एज्यूम दैट एज 50%. सो 50% ऑफ 80,000 विल बी 40,000. हेंस वॉट इज लेफ्ट विद द कंपनी आफ्टर डिडक्टिंग टैक्स इज नेट प्रॉफिट आफ्टर टैक्स, दैट इज 40,000. Now this is an example where a company has raised debt and the company is paying interest on that debt as 20,000. Now let us consider another example of a company with same net profit before interest and tax, but its capital structure does not include any debt. So let us understand that. So 1 lakh is net profit before interest and tax, but the capital structure does not includes any debt fund. So dash, there is no interest to be paid. So net profit before interest and tax in such case will be 1 lakh. Less 50% tax will be 50,000. Okay. And net profit after tax is 50,000. Now let us understand this concept. Here the tax paid by the company is 40,000 because the company has employed debt fund in its capital structure. Whereas here the tax paid by the company is 50,000, that is more, because the company don't have a debt fund in its capital structure. That means that if we involve debt fund in the capital structure, we get an advantage as far as payment of tax is concerned. That means payment of tax is, we have to pay a lower tax if we involve debt fund in our capital structure. So this concept is called as concept of tax shield. So when we say कि वी हैव टेकन अप अ लोन, या द कंपनी इज पेइंग एन इंटरेस्ट ऑफ 10%, सो वी हैव टेकन अप अ लोन विच कैरीज 10% रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट, देन ट्रूली स्पीकिंग बिकॉज ऑफ दिस टैक्स शील्ड द कंपनी डज नॉट एंड अप पेइंग एफेक्टिव 10%. द एफेक्टिव रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट दैट द कंपनी पेज बिकम्स द कॉस्ट ऑफ डेट फॉर दैट कंपनी. सो लेट अस अंडरस्टैंड दिस कॉन्सेप्ट इन डिटेल. ओके, सो लेट मी रब दिस फर्स्ट. So I hope you have understood this concept of tax shield, and we will be further looking how this tax shield is to be used for calculating the effective rate of interest. So when it comes to debt fund, so term loan, for example, then if the term loan carries a rate of interest of 10%, then the cost of that term loan is 10%, but because of the availability of phenomenon of tax shield, the effective rate becomes lower. So let us see that. So KT. So KT is an expression that is used for showing cost of term loan is equals to interest. So there is a fixed component of interest involved, but this interest is to be lowered by tax component. So this is after tax component we have to multiply, that is 1 minus T. Now this is important. This is what you have to remember. And this tax component is to be used in all debt finances. So this becomes the formula for your cost of term loan. So cost of term loan simply means interest bracket 1 minus T. Let us understand this with the help of an example. For example, if the company raises a term loan which carries a rate of interest say 8%, and the company is in the tax bracket of 50%, then let us calculate the effective rate of interest that the company ends up paying. So that is equals to 8% bracket 1 minus T. 50% can be written as 50 upon 100, that is 0.5. So this is 0.5. So that is 8% into 0.5. So this is 4%. That means if the company falls in a 50% tax bracket, and if the company pays an 8% interest, then the effective cost of capital of that term loan is only 4%. So this is the concept of tax shield, and this is the formula for calculation of cost of term loan. Now let us understand the cost of debentures. So debentures or bonds is also a category of debt fund. But when it comes to debentures, the debentures can be either irredeemable debentures, that is perpetual debentures, or there can may be redeemable debentures. Now, irremediable debentures are that debentures for which there is no fixed period of debentures. That is, there is no maturity period. Now, further, when it comes to debentures, the debentures can be issued at par, or the debentures can be issued at premium or discount. So let us understand the two concepts separately. If irredeemable debentures are issued at par, then the formula for calculation of cost of debentures, that is KD, now the expression used is KD, is equals to I bracket 1 minus T, which is same as your formula for calculation of term loan. So here the formula is same as term loan, I bracket 1 minus T, since the debentures are issued at par. But if the debentures are not issued at par, if they are issued at premium or discount, then the company receives a value which is higher than the face value. Now that is called as net proceeds. So net proceeds involved in this example is higher than your face value. So net proceeds will be equals to face value plus premium or minus discount, as the case may be. Okay, so this is plus premium or minus discount. So net proceeds that the company receive will be either higher than the face value or then lower than the face value, depending upon whether the company is issuing it at a premium or discount. But in this case, if the face value is 100, then the company receives net proceeds as 100. So in this case, there is no difference between net proceeds and face value. But in this case, if the company issue face value of the debentures is 100, and if the company issues it at 10% premium, then the proceeds that the company receives is 110. Or if the company issues it at discount, then the proceeds that the company receives is 90 rupees. So in this case, net proceeds also comes in picture in the formula of cost of debt. So let us understand the cost of debt in this example. So KD in this example will be I bracket 1 minus T, but this I is to be divided with NP, because the net proceeds is different from the face value as far as this sum is concerned. So I hope you have understood the formula for KD when irredeemable debentures are issued at par, and the formula when irredeemable debentures are issued at premium or discount. So when it is issued at premium or a discount, the important thing is to calculate net proceeds, and net proceeds can be calculated as face value plus premium or discount, as the case may be. Now let us understand the formula for cost of redeemable debentures. When it comes to redeemable debentures over and above net proceeds concept has a concept of redeemable value, because you have to redeem it after a certain number of years. So they have a concept of redeemable value. Again, they have a concept of number of years. So how this component is to be used in the formula, let us see what is the formula for calculation of cost of redeemable debentures. So in this case, KD will be equals to I bracket 1 minus T plus RV minus NP. So RV is redeemable value, because when it comes to redeemable debentures, it has got a redeemable value, upon N. It has got a fixed period, so upon N, divided by the average investment, that is RV minus NP. RV plus NP upon 2. So this is how average investment is calculated. So that is to be divided with average investment. So let us write down the component. We know what does I means. I means interest. We know what is NP. So NP is face value plus premium, if it is issued at premium, minus discount if it is issued at discount. And to understand further, sometimes the company have to bear flotation cost for issue of debentures or shares. So this is to be deducted minus flotation cost if it is involved in the issue. Okay, So it will be deducted with flotation cost, and this becomes our formula for calculation of net proceeds that the company receives on issue of debentures or shares. Now, RV is redeemable value. And how to calculate redeemable value? Now, redeemable value is again face value. If it is redeemed at premium, then plus premium. And if it is redeemed at discount, then minus discount. So this is the formula for calculation of RV, that is redeemable value. And T is tax rate, that we know. And N is period, which is nothing but number of years. That is the maturity period. So these are the components of the formula when cost of in order to calculate cost of redeemable debentures. Now let us use this with the help of example. So here, Tenda Limited has rupees 3 lakhs 10% debentures of rupees 100 each. The tax rate is 50%. Calculate the cost of debentures. Now, dear students, here they have not mentioned the period of redemption. That means we will be assuming this debenture as perpetual debentures or irredeemable debentures. Now, perpetual or irredeemable debentures, may we have seen that they are either issued at par or they are issued at premium or discount. Now, here the debentures are issued at par. So, this is irredeemable debentures issued at par wala type. So, here the formula that we are going to use is KD will be equals to I bracket 1 minus T. So the simple formula that we are going to use, KD is equals to I bracket T, where I stands for interest. So the interest rate given in the problem is 10%. So I is 10%, bracket 1 minus T, the tax rate is 50%, 50% is 0.5. So we are writing here 0.5. So this is 10% into 0.5, which is 5%. So this is KD as far as this example is concerned. So this is irredeemable debentures. Irredeemable debentures and issued at par. So example of irredeemable debentures issued at par. Now let us see an example where irredeemable debentures are issued at premium. So Raghav Limited issued 25,000 12% debentures rupees 100 each at 10% premium. So here the debentures are issued at premium. So net proceeds will be involved in this example. The tax rate is 30%. Calculate the cost of debentures. Again, we have to understand the period of debenture is not mentioned. So we'll be assuming this as irredeemable debentures. So the formula for irredeemable debentures issued at premium or discount will be KD is equals to I bracket 1 minus T, but we will be dividing this with NP because net proceeds is involved in this sum. So let us calculate the value of net proceeds and interest. So I in this example will be 12%. So 12% will be calculated of the face value, and the face value is 100. So 12% of 100 will be equals to rupees 12. So interest factor in this example is rupees 12, whereas net proceed will be equals to face value plus premium. So this sum involves premium, so I'm adding premium to this. That is 100 rupees is the face value plus 10% premium. Now this 10% is to be calculated of 100 rupees, that is face value. Premium or discount is always calculated on the face value. So this is 100 into 10%. So that will be equals to 100 plus 10 rupees. So this is 110. So net proceeds that the company is going to receive on issue of this debentures is 110 rupees. The tax rate is given to us as 30%, which is 30 upon 100, that is 0.3. So let us use this in the calculation. So as we have seen the formula, KD will be equals to I. Now I is 12 rupees upon NP. So NP net proceed is 110 bracket 1 minus T is 0.3. So this is equals to 12 upon 110 into 0.7. So that is equals to, let us calculate. So 12 divided by 110 into 0.7. So this is equals to 0.0763. Now, as a rule, what we are going to do, we are going to denote this cost of debentures in the form of percentage, because it is a rate of return. So rate of return, we'll be denoting it in form of percentage. So for denoting this in the form of percentage, we'll be multiplying it with 100. So this can be stated as 7.63%. So that is your rate of return, which is called as the cost of capital. So always do remember to multiply it with 100 and to denote it in the form of percentage. Now let us see an example of redeemable debentures. Surya Limited has raised the funds through issue of 10,000 debentures of 100 each at a discount of rupees 10 per share. So the debentures are issued at discount with 10 years maturity. Now look at this point. They have given us the maturity period. That means here there is maturity period, that is N is involved. So this is a redeemable debenture ka type. The coupon rate. Now coupon rate is simply means interest rate. So this is your interest rate. So interest rate involved is 16%. The flotation cost is 5%. So here, while issuing debenture, there is a flotation cost involved. The debentures are redeemable with 10% with a 10% premium. So this is redeemable value. The debentures are redeemed after 10 years at 10% premium. The corporate tax rate is given to us as 40%. Calculate the cost of debenture. So this is an example of redeemable debentures. So the formula is KD will be equals to I bracket 1 minus T plus RV minus NP upon N bracket close the whole upon RV plus NP upon 2. Okay. So this is the formula. So as per this formula, let us calculate each of the component for this sum I. So I'm calculating it over here. I will be equals to, now interest, the coupon rate is 16%, and as we have seen, the interest is always calculated on the face value. So 100 rupees is the face value of debentures into 16%. So this is rupees 16. So I is rupees 16. Then comes NP, net proceeds. Now in this sum, the formula for calculation of net proceeds is face value minus discount. So the debentures are issued at discount. So face value minus discount, the whole minus flotation cost. So that will be equals to face value is 100 rupees minus the discount at the time of issue is 10, the whole minus flotation cost. But flotation cost is not given us in rupees, it is given us in percentage, that is 5%. Now this 5% is to be calculated on the, what the mistake students does is they calculate 5% on the face value, that is 100. But here you have to remember one point. Flotation cost is not to be calculated on the face value. The flotation cost is to be calculated on issue price, which in this sum is rupees 90. So 90 is 100 minus 10. So you have to calculate it on the issue price. So issue price is rupees 90 as far as this sum is concerned. If this debentures had issued at premium, then the issue price would be, suppose 10 rupees ka premium, then the issue price would be 110. So flotation cost is always to be calculated on issue price. That is an underlining point. So this is equals to 90 minus 4.5. So that is equals to 85.5. 90 minus 4.5, so that is equals to 85.5. So this is your net proceeds as far as this sum is concerned. Then redeemable value is face value plus premium, because you are redeeming it at premium. So it is face value plus premium. The face value is rupees 100 plus the premium that you're going to pay is 10%, and we have seen premium and discount is always calculated on the face value, so it is 10% of 100. So this will be equals to 100 plus 110 rupees, that is 110. So redeemable value is 110. Now the number of years, that is n, is 10 years, and the tax rate as far as this sum is concerned is 40%. So 40% is 0.4. So these are the components for calculation of cost of redeemable debentures. So let us use this component for calculation of debentures, cost of debentures. So I, interest is 16, bracket 1 minus 0.4, that is the tax rate, plus RV is 110, minus net proceeds on issue of debentures 85.5, upon n is 10 years, the whole upon RV is 110 plus 85.5 upon 2, since we have to calculate the average, we'll be dividing it with 2. So this is equals to 16 into 0.6 plus 110 minus 85.5 divided by 10. So that's going to be 2.45 upon, the average is 110 plus 85.5 divided by 2. So that is equals to 97.75. So let us solve this further. So 16 into 0.6. So that is 9.6 plus 2.45, the whole upon 97.75. So this is equals to 9.6 plus 2.45. So that is 12.05 upon 97.75. So 12.05 divided by 97.75. So that is equals to 0.1233. Now, as we have seen, we have to convert it into percentage. So multiplying it with 100, the cost of this fund will be 12.33%. So this is how you have to calculate cost of redeemable debentures. I hope this is clear. Now further, let us understand how to calculate cost of preference shares. Now again, when it comes to preference shares, preference shares can be irredeemable, preference shares can be redeemable. Now the difference between your debentures and preference shares is both as the similarities, both has fixed component, but as we have seen, debentures may we will be getting a tax shield advantage, which is not so in case of preference shares. Why? Because interest is a charge on profit that we have seen, whereas dividend is an appropriation out of profit, and hence there is no such concept of tax shield involved in preference shares. So how to calculate the cost of irredeemable preference shares? The cost of irredeemable preference shares, that is KP, again here, if it is issued at par and if it is issued at premium / discount, so the formula will be same as your debenture ka formula. So KP will be equals to, yahan pe we have to pay dividend, so it is preference dividend, but here there is no tax shield, so we are not going to multiply it with 1 minus T, and since it is issued at par, the face value and net proceeds will be equal, so no need of dividing it with NP as well. So here the formula simply means whatever dividend the preference shareholders are to be paid, now that becomes the cost of your irredeemable preferences. So cost of preferential is equals to the dividend component that is to be paid, that is the rate of dividend that is to be paid in this example. But if the preferences are issued at premium or discount, then the formula involved would be KP will be equals to preference dividend upon NP. So here we have to divide it with NP in order to calculate your cost of preference shares, and we have seen एनपी इज नथिंग बट नेट प्रोसीड्स विच इज फेस वैल्यू प्लस प्रीमियम स्लैश डिस्काउंट द होल सब्ट्रैक्टेड द होल रिड्यूस्ड बाय फ्लोटेशन कॉस्ट इफ इट इज इन्वॉल्व. Now let us understand the second part, that is redeemable preferences. Again the formula is similar to your cost of redeemable debentures because both have got a fixed component. So here KP will be equals to preference dividend. So instead of I am writing preference dividend, but there I have multiplied it with tax component, tax shield, that is 1 minus t. Here we are not going to get a tax shield because it is dividend involved, so no need of multiplying it with 1 minus t. Further plus RV, here also redeemable value will be involved, minus net proceeds upon N, so that is same, the whole upon RV plus NP upon 2. So the formula for preferences and formula for debentures is quite similar because both have a fixed component involved, but the only difference is that of tax shield. Okay, so let us see this with the help of an example. XYZ Limited issues 2000 10% preference shares. But before starting the example, it is to be noted that as far as Companies Act is concerned, we are not allowed to issue irredeemable preference shares. That means the preferences that are going to be issued are only redeemable. So irredeemable preferences are not allowed by Companies Act. So only redeemable preferences are going to be issued. So let us see that example. XYZ Limited issues 2000 10% preferential of rupees 100 each at rupees 95 per share, redeemable after 10 years. Calculate the cost of preferences. So here the preferences are issued at a discount, that is at 95 rupees. So let us write down the formula first. KP will be equals to PD plus RV minus NP upon N, the whole upon RV plus NP upon 2. So let us write down the component. So here PD is preference dividend, which is nothing but 10%, and dividend is again to be calculated on the face value. So this is 100 into 10%, that is rupees 10. So preference dividend per debenture, per preference shares, is rupees 10. Then we have net proceeds to be calculated. Net proceeds they have given to us as 95 because the company is issuing it at a discount. So net proceeds that the company is going to receive is 95 rupees. Redeemable value. Now there is no mention of any redeemable value, whether it is redeemed at premium or discount. So we will be assuming it is redeemed at par. That means the redeemable value will be equal to the face value, that is rupees 100. And the number of years after which it is redeemed is 10 years. The tax rate involved. Now this is important. Tax rate involved. Now we don't have to look at the tax rate because there is no tax shield involved. So let us use this for the calculation of cost of preferences. So PD is 10 plus RV is 100 minus NP 95 upon 10, the whole upon 100 plus 95 upon 2. Now this is equals to 10 plus 0.5 upon 195 divided by 2. So the average is 97.5. So this is equals to 10.5 upon 97.5. So the final answer is equals to 0.1077. Now as we know, we will be converting this into percentage for denoting it as a rate. So 10.77% is your cost of preference shares. Let us see one more example. A company issued 40,000 12% redeemable preference shares of rupees 100 each at a premium of 5 each. So here the preference shares are issued at premium. Redeemable after 10 years at a premium of 10 each. So again redeemable at premium. The flotation cost involved is rupees 2. So here flotation cost is also involved. You are required to calculate the cost of preference shares. So again, let us calculate each of the component. First PD. PD will be equals to 100 into 12%. 12% is the rate of preference dividend that is to be paid. So rupees 12 is your preference dividend. Then net proceeds in this sum will be equals to face value plus premium, because it is issued at premium, the whole minus, it will be reduced with the flotation cost involved. Flotation cost, that is the formula for calculating net proceeds. So face value is equals to 100 plus 5 rupees is the premium deducted by, now in this sum flotation cost is given us as rupees 2, so there is no percentage involved, so straight away we can write 2 rupees flotation cost. So this is 105 minus 2 is 103 rupees. That is the net proceeds that you are going to receive on issue of preference shares. Further, redeemable value. Redeemable value is face value plus premium. Now the preference shares are going to redeemed at premium. So face value involved is 100 plus premium that the company is going to pay at the time of redemption is 10 rupees. So premium is 10. So redeemable value is 110. And the number of years after which is the company is going to redeem the preference shares is 10 years. And there is no need for any tax component. So let us use the formula. KP is equals to preference dividend plus RV minus NP upon N, the whole upon RV plus NP upon 2. So this is equals to 12 plus RV is 110 minus NP is 103 upon number of years is 10, the whole upon 110 plus 103 upon 2. So let us solve this. So this is equals to 12 plus 110 minus 103 divided by 10, that is going to be 0.7 upon 110 plus 103 divided by 2. So that is going to be 106.5. So let us solve this. So this is 12.7 upon 106.5. So 12.7 divided by 106.5, that's equals to 0.1192. So denoting this into percentage, it will be 11.92%. That is your cost of preference shares as far as this problem is concerned. Now further, let us understand and calculate cost of equity shares, that is KE. So as we have seen, equity share does not carries any fixed dividend, but the expectations of your shareholders as against the dividend and the expectation of the shareholders for the growth in dividend forms the basis for calculation of your cost of equity shares. So KE ka formula can be written as D. D stands for dividend per share upon MPS or net proceeds. So if it is an existing shares, then market price will be involved. And if it is a new shares that we are going to issue, then net proceeds will be involved. So D upon MPS or NP, depending upon it is existing shares or new issue, into 100, or converting this into percentage, the whole plus G, that is the growth rate being given. So let us write down this component. D is dividend per share, which is the expected dividend per share, MPS इज मार्केट प्राइस पर शेयर, देन एनपी इज अगेन द नेट प्रोसीड्स, एंड वी नो हाउ टू कैलकुलेट नेट प्रोसीड्स, एंड जी स्टैंड्स फॉर द ग्रोथ रेट इन डिविडेंड दैट योर इक्विटी शेयर होल्डर्स एक्सपेक्ट्स. सो जी इज द ग्रोथ रेट. सो दिस इज द फॉर्मूला दैट वी आर गोइंग टू यूज फॉर कैलकुलेशन ऑफ कॉस्ट ऑफ इक्विटी. लेट अस सी दिस विद द हेल्प ऑफ एन एग्जाम्पल. द इक्विटी of Mercury Limited are traded in the market at rupees 90 each. So here market price is involved, that is MPS is 90. The expected current year dividend per share is rupees 18. So D is 18. The subsequent growth in dividend is expected at the rate of 6%. So G involved is 6%. Calculate the cost of equity capital. So we know the formula. KE is equals to D upon MPS, that is market price per share, into 100 bracket close plus growth rate. So this is the formula. So let us solve. So dividend is 18, market price per share is 90 into 100. So this will convert this into percentage, plus growth rate is already given to us in percentage, that is 6%. So we'll be keep writing it as 6%. So this is 18 divided by 90 percentage. So this will be 20%. The bracket will give us an answer of 20% plus 6%. So 20% plus 6%. That means the cost of equity will be 26%. So this is the formula for calculation of cost of equity depending upon the expectation of dividend as well as the growth rate that the equity shareholders are expecting. Let us further see. The dividend per share is rupees 18 and it sells for rupees 118. So dividend is given, D is given, and it sells for, that is market price per share is given as 118. Then calculate the cost of equity shares. Now here growth rate is not being given to us. So let us calculate the cost of equity shares. So KE will be equals to, we know the formula, D upon MPS into 100 and plus G. But this sum does not include any growth rate. They have not given us. So there is no use of this G. So even though if you don't write plus G, still it's okay. So D is 18 upon 118 into 100. So this is equals to 18 divided by 118. So 18 divided by 118 percentage. So that is equals to 15.25%. This is your KE when the growth rate is not given to us. Further, next we will be calculating cost of retained earnings. As we have seen, retained earnings carries an implicit cost. So cost of retained earnings is dependent on cost of equity shares. Now let us understand the concept of retained earnings in detail. For example, if the earning per share is 100 and the company declares a dividend of 70%, that is company gives us 70 rupees as dividend out of that earning, then what is left is called as the retained earning. That means the company has retained an earning of 30 rupees. So this retained earnings are that part of earnings which is not distributed as dividend. So here what the equity shareholders will be expecting, since the company has kept their 30 rupees, the equity shareholder will be expecting the same rate as they're expecting from their equity shares. So here simply writing KR will be equals to KE. So they will be assuming the same rate of return that they're expecting on equity share, because the 30 rupees belongs to the equity shareholders, which the company has not distributed and has kept with them for the purpose of further investment. So your equity shareholders will be expecting the cost of retained earning will be the same as KE. But there are two things that we have to consider before calculating KR. Now what are that two things involved? If this 30 rupees is paid is not retained by the company, if it is given in the hands of equity shareholders, then that will become an income of equity shareholders, which will attract tax. So here individual tax will be attracted if it is not kept by the company. So individual tax component is involved. Further, if this 30 rupees is given in the hands of equity shareholders, then that 30 rupees will be reinvested in some other firm by your equity shareholders, which will attract brokerage at the time of investments. Okay, so if 30 rupees is given to the equity shareholders, then this will be attracting tax component as well as it will be attracting brokerage. But now, since the company has retained this earning, the equity shareholders are not to be paid with this cost. That means this cost is not involved. So that means KR can be finally calculated, the cost of retained earnings can be finally calculated as KE reduced by 1 minus T, that is the personal tax component. Final formula for calculation of KR. So KR will be equals to KE 1 minus TP reduced by 1 minus personal tax of the equity shareholders and 1 minus brokerage of the equity shareholders. Since equity shareholders is not receiving, so they don't have to pay that tax. That means the cost is reduced to that extent and they don't have to pay brokerage for reinvesting it. So the cost is also reduced to that extent. So this two component, the reduction component, is to be remembered while calculation of cost of retained earnings. Now let us see this with the help of an example. Yasmin Limited retains 750,000 out of its current earnings. The expected rate of return to its shareholders if they have invested the funds elsewhere is 10%. So 10% is what your shareholders are expecting. So this is your KE. The expectation of your shareholders is the cost of equity capital. Okay. The brokerage is 3%. So if the retained earnings are received by the equity shareholder, they would have paid brokerage for investment. So 3% is the brokerage, and shareholders come in 30% tax bracket. So this is the individual tax component. So individual tax rate is 30%. Calculate the cost of retained earnings. So KR, the formula for calculation of KR, as we have seen, is KE bracket 1 minus individual tax component, that is tax personal, 1 minus brokerage. So let us see. This is equals to KE is 10%, 1 minus personal tax rate involved is 3%. 3% can be written as 0.3 bracket 1 minus brokerage. The brokerage that is involved is 30%. Tax rate is 30%, so 0.3. The brokerage that is involved is 3%, so it is 0.03. 3% is 0.03. So this is equals to 10% into 0.7 into 0.97. So let us calculate this. So 10 into 0.7 into 0.97. So that gives me the answer of 6.79, and percentage. So we'll be writing percentage because I have not touched percentage in the calculation. So percentage will be as it is. 6.79% is what KR is. So cost of retained earnings will be lower than the cost of equity because of individual tax component and the brokerage factor. I hope this is clear. So KR will be equals to KE reduced by individual tax component and brokerage. Now this is what cost of individual capital was. Individual capital fund was, that is, we have calculated cost of debentures, we have calculated cost of term loans, we have calculated cost of preferences, and we have calculated cost of equity shares as well as retained earnings. But truly speaking, a company goes for a mixture of all the components. So if a mixture of all the components are involved, then the most important thing that the company is to calculate is the overall cost of capital. We have calculated individual cost of capital, but as far as the company is concerned, the company goes for an optimum mix of all these capital funds. That means the company has to calculate the overall cost of capital, which is nothing but the weighted average of the individual cost of capital that the company have calculated. So that means we have to calculate weighted average cost of capital for a company. Which is also called as WACC, WACC. So WACC is the weighted average cost of capital. This will be calculated by assigning weights to the individual cost of capital that we have calculated. Now, how to assign weights? The weights will be depending upon the proportion of capital that is involved in the total capital of the company. Now, what does that mean? Let us look with the help of an example. So let us calculate the weighted average cost of capital or the overall cost of capital for a company. And we have calculated the cost of capital for each component. Now let us average that and calculate weighted average. So Pablo Limited has the following capital structure. So Pablo Limited may have issued equity shares, 2 lakh equity shares of 10 each, and the capital involved is 20 lakhs. Reserves and surplus, so they have retained earnings of 20 lakhs, 12% preference shares of 10 lakhs and 9% debentures of 30 lakhs. So the total capital of Pablo Limited is 80 lakhs. Further, the market price of equity share is rupees 30. It is expected that the company will pay next year a dividend of 3 per share, which will grow at 7% forever. Assume 40% income tax rate. You are required to compute weighted average cost of capital. So how to calculate weighted average cost of capital? Weighted average cost of capital is nothing but the average of individual cost of capital. So first we will be calculating the individual cost of capital for these four sources, and then we will be calculating the average of this. So let us see. So first is cost of equity. And cost of equity is calculated with the formula KE. And we have seen what is the formula of KE. So this will be a revision of what we have done. What is the formula of KE? KE is D upon MPS. There is a market price involved into 100. The whole plus growth rate. Now let us see how much is the dividend component. So here they have given the next year the company is going to pay a dividend of 3 rupees. So D is 3 rupees upon how much is the market price plus per share equity share? The market price is 30. So upon 30 into 100 plus G. So growth rate is given to us as 7%. That will grow at 7% forever. So growth rate is 7%. So that means the KE involved in this sum is 10% plus 7%. So that is equals to 17%. So KE for this sum is 17%. So that is your first component. Second is reserves and surplus. So let us write down the formula for reserves and surplus. That is cost of retained earnings. That is the second fund involved. So cost of retained earnings, KR, will be equals to, as we have seen, KE. KR is equals to KE, but it is reduced by 1 minus individual tax rate and 1 minus brokerage. But in this sum, there is no individual tax rate given to us, as well as there is no brokerage involved. So in this sum, KR will simply be equals to KE, and hence KR is also equals to 17%. Okay. Further, next is preference share. This is 12% preference share. So cost of preference shares. So cost of preference shares, that is KP, will be equals to, now in this sum they have not given us the redeemable value as well as the number of years involved. So we will be assuming this as irredeemable debentures and 12% preference shares. So simply the formula for KP will be preference dividend, that is equals to 12%. So here KP will be simply 12%, because there is no net proceeds involved, there is no redeemable value, and there is no mention of any maturity period. So KP will be simply equals to preference dividend. Next is cost of debentures. this is the last component in your sources of funds. So cost of debentures. As far as debentures is concerned, we have a 9% debenture, so the interest rate is 9%, but debentures has got a tax shield. So there is a tax advantage involved. So we will be multiplying it with 1 minus T. So the tax rate is 40%. That is a corporate tax rate being given to us. That is 40%. And they have not mentioned anything about the redeemable value. So we will be assuming this as irredeemable debentures. So irredeemable debentures issued at par. The formula is KD will be equals to I bracket 1 minus T, and there is no need for writing net proceeds because the debentures are issued at par. That's what we are assuming. So here the interest that is to be paid on debenture is 9% bracket. The tax rate is 40%. So 40% will be written as 1 minus 0.4. So this will be equals to 9% into 0.6. So I'm not going to touch percentage. I'm going to multiply 9 into 0.6. So 9 into 0.6 is going to be 5.4, and I'm going to write percentage as it is. So this is 5.4%. So that is your cost of debentures as far as this sum is concerned. So we have calculated individual cost of capital for each of the four components. Now what is our job is to calculate the average of this. So how to calculate weighted average? So let us compute weighted average. So computation of overall cost of capital, that is computation of weighted average cost of capital, WACC. So for that we will be drawing a table. Sources, amount involved, then weights, we'll be assigning weights. We'll be multiplying the weights with cost of individual capital, that is cost of capital, and we'll be getting our weighted average cost of capital. So these are the columns involved for calculation of weighted average cost of capital. So source mein, the first source was equity shares. And the amount that we have raised by equity shares is 20 lakhs. So amount is 20 lakhs. Equity share ka amount in total capital is 20 lakhs. Then we have reserves, that is retained earnings. Again the amount is 20 lakhs. Then we have preference shares. The amount is 10 lakhs. And we have debentures. The amount is 30 lakhs. So the total capital that we have is 80 lakhs. I hope this is clear. So the total capital involved is 80 lakhs. Now the most important thing is to assign weights. Now how to assign weights to this capital? Now weights will be assigned in the proportion of their amount in the total capital. That means for assigning weights, the total capital will be considered as 1, and accordingly the weights will be assigned to each of the components. So for 20 lakhs, the weight will be, it is 20 lakh out of 80 lakhs. So weight will be 20 divided by 80. So the weight assigned to this capital is 0.25. So the involvement of 20 lakh in the total capital is 0.25. So in the proportion of their involvement in the total capital, will be assigning weight. So equity share will be assigned a weight of 0.25. Reserves and surplus will again be assigned a weight of 0.25 because the amount is 20 lakh. So it will be assigned a weight of 0.25. Preference share ka amount is 10 lakh in the total capital, which is 10 divided by 80. So the amount, weights that is assigned is 0.125. And the weight that is assigned to debenture is 30 divided by 80, that is 0.375. So look at this. The capital which is, the capital whose amount is greater will be assigned a higher weight. The capital whose amount is lower will be assigned a lower weight, and the total of weights will be 1. So this is how you assign weights to your amount. Now cost of capital. Cost of capital, we have calculated it for equity shares. The cost of capital was 17%. So 17% for reserves and surplus, the cost of capital was again 17%. For preference share, the cost of capital was 12%. And for debentures, the cost of capital is 5.4%. So multiplying weights into cost of capital, will be getting WACC. So WACC, that is WACC, is cost of capital into the weights assigned. So it is a product of cost of capital and weights. Okay. So this is equals to 17. So I'm not going to touch percentage. So it is 17 into 0.25. So 17 into 0.25. So that's going to be 4.25%. Here again, it is 17 into 0.25. So it is 4.25%. Here it is 0.125 into 12. So it is 1.5%. And 0.375 into 5.4. So that's equals to 2.025%. So getting a total of all the components, so 0.025% plus 1.5 plus 4.25 and again plus 4.25, we get the answer as 12.025%. Now this 12.025% is nothing but your weighted average cost of capital. So this is your weighted average cost of capital, that is the overall cost of capital for employing 80 lakhs through different sources of funds.